truth is in our hearts. And none will tell you this but your father. Men hate the gods. The only reason we worship any of them is because we fear worse.
What's worse?
Titans.
If they were ever to be set free, it would be a darkness such as we've never seen.
Could they ever come back? Didn't Zeus imprison the Titans forever under Mount Olympus?
It's said that when Zeus burned them to dust with his lightning bolt, he took the Titans' ashes and in cold revenge mixed it with those of mortal men.
Why?
Who knows these things?
One day, things will change. Men will change. But first, the gods must change. But all this you'll forget, Alexander. It's why we call them myths. We can't bear to remember them.
I'll remember. And one day I'll be on walls like these.
You're wrong and you're right, Philip of Macedonia. Speaking through Val Kilmer and Oliver Stone's mostly flawed film, Alexander. Men do hate the gods, and Zeus, that representation of the demiurge, did curse us in so many ways. More than imagined, as you true seeker warriors will find out on this episode of Aeon Bitnostic Radio. But Philip, we are not just a mixture of Titan dust. As the cult of Orpheus claimed, humans are Titan as well as the essence of the felled and fallen Dionysus, that archetypal incarnation of possibility and the boundless. I'm sure Prometheus knew this, as he, along with Athena, was forced to make us, all to be slaves and playthings of Olympus. And no, Philip, these myths are more than stories, as I've been blabbering about for most of the episodes this summer. Myths are more than fiction, and more than mundane reality. They are the true reality and history of eternity. Our multiverse is made of narratives, and myth is the font.
History became legend. Legend became myth.
And yes, Alexander, you did make it to Olympus after your teacher, Aristotle, had you killed. But just to become another catamite of the creator gods. You were lucky, perhaps. As the saying goes, those whom the gods wish to destroy, they first make mad.
You are specks of dust beneath our fingernails. Your very breath is a gift from Olympus. You have insulted powers beyond your comprehension.
We shall be dealing with those Greek myths, and myth in general, during these Anubis days of summer. I keep saying these are Gnostic times, but maybe I was a tad wrong. Perhaps it's always been Gnostic times, my beloved true seekers. The gods have always used us as chattel, always cast counterfeit realities over our divine senses. The hologram just keeps shifting over the empire. And they're always stacking the decks of fate against the inventor and the dreamer, casting us down with the god in the gutter of Philip K. Dick with the despised Philosopher's Stone. The hologram just keeps shifting over the empire. It's always been this way. And even back in ancient times, the philosopher and the playwright knew this. It's always been Gnostic times. The hologram shifts.
What truth? That you are a slave, Neo.
Like everyone else, you were born into bondage. Born into a prison that you cannot smell or taste or touch. A prison for your mind.
That is what you'll find in this eternal now. Oh, you modern-day Tom Sawyers, your mind not for rent by any god or government. You revenge of the myth, as Gershom Scholem called the Gnostic Kabbalah. You are shards of Dionysus and sighs of Hagia Sophia. You, who are so beautiful and can do so many wonders, I just know it. And that's why you came here.
One day, somebody's gonna have to make a stand. One day, somebody's gonna have to say enough.
To make this case and more, we are joined by Adrienne Mayer, author of one of my favorite books this year, Gods and Robots, Myths, Machines, and Ancient Dreams of Technology. Adrienne is the author of many other excellent books, like The Amazons and The Poison King, and is a research scholar in classics and the history of science at Stanford University. So honored to have the august Adrienne materialize at the virtual Alexandria.
Trust the gods, Leonidas.
I'd prefer you trusted your reason.
Adrienne makes so many intriguing and sober cases in Gods and Robots for those eternal Gnostic times and much more. Her work is so relevant. You see, beyond the tension of gods and humans, the ideas of transhumanism, robotics, and AI have been around for thousands of years in both the East and the West, as Adrienne argues. And the perils and opportunities of technology in general, as well as the destructive hand of those who dwell on Olympus, who manipulate that technology while hoarding the resources.
Call no man happy who is not dead.
Release the Kraken!
What we're facing today has always been occurring in mundane reality and the true reality and history of eternity that is myth. In the heavens and hells around us, nothing has changed. The hologram keeps shifting over the Empire.
The Empire is the institution, the codification of derangement. It is insane and imposes its insanity on us by violence, since its nature is a violent one.
I mean, did you know that the Trojan War was never about some e-girl face who launched 1,000 shitposts? Sorry, Ellen of Troy, you consort of Simon Magus. But it actually happened because Zeus, that supreme technocrat, just thought the world was too overpopulated with humans and decided to do what any archon would do. Divide and conquer, and then watch civilizations burn. In essence, the demiurge has always been playing the eugenics game, just as much as he seduced humans with dreams of, yes, robotics, transhumanism, and AI.
My replicants will live as long or as short as a customer will pay. My replicants will never rebel. They will never run. They will simply obey.
Hey, you children of Prometheus and Athena. Don't look into your Dionysus essence. I'll make some of you immortal. I'll let you play in Olympus with Alexander and his Irish accent. I'll give you wings bound by wax and your own startup in Silicon Valley after you drop out of Stanford. Rock on, Elizabeth Holmes. Just sign your soul and screw over 99% of your brothers and sisters. Keep that golden fleece and stock options and your DMT sabbaticals. But just make sure they never wake up. You'll be a god. You'll fly on the Lolita Express to the palace of Aphrodite. never let them know that when Athena and Prometheus made humanity, they secretly programmed in them the doom of me, Zeus. They must not remember, even if Plato said all learning is remembering.
You cannot play God, then wash your hands of the things that you've created. Sooner or later, the day comes and you can't hide from the things that you've done anymore.
We're remembering, Father Sky. We see you behind the curtain of history, written by the victors, and those holy texts, written by the vicars, as Vance likes to say. We see you like Prometheus and Medea and Euripides and Socrates and Sappho and Val Kilmer with his fake Irish accent. Like the ancient Gnostics. We're waking up to our sacred quest in both mundane reality and the reality in the history of eternity that is myth. You're going down, Demiurge. And works like gods and robots and all the wonderful guests of Aeon Byte are part of this revolution of the spirit and the mind. In the name of Hypatia of Alexandria.
God will have his vengeance.
I think your God is afraid of me.
So thanks for being here on this awakening with your host, Miguel Connor, your humble servant and pompous of Gnosis. Each one of you is dead Titan dust and the sparks of Dionysus, that sublime place where the fallen angel meets a rising ape, that unique point and nexus where imagination comes alive and potential is realized, and the gods wish they could have.
And yet in the midst of all this darkness, I see some people who will not be bound. I see some people who will not give up, even when they know all hope is lost. Some people who realize that being lost is so close to being found.
Woo! There I go again with the long drivel intro. Thanks for entertaining my Discordian myth-making and Gen X mythopoeia this summer. And hope you've enjoyed it. I feel I've been chased by archons these last months, so I need to bring out what is within me, or it will kill me, as the Gospel of Thomas says. Frank DeVita thinks it's Jesus chasing me, and we shall see if I finally break down as I try to break mundane reality down for you, as always.
Well, it's not really a measure of mental health to be well adjusted in a society that's very sick.
We could only do about an hour with Adrienne. She was vacationing in the Montana wilderness for the summer during the interview, as I chased her because her scholarship was so amazing. There was so much more we could have covered, so get the book, even if this interview will blow you away. As a bonus for members and patrons, Vance and I discussed the interview. Since Vance is very, very familiar with Silicon Valley and the military-industrial complex, he provided some amazing insights. You'll love it. As a further bonus, I'm adding the section of our interview with Jason Reza Giorgiani on his book, Prometheus and Atlas, where he presents a framework where we can use the power of the Titans against the Olympian gods of any age or geography. More needed than ever. Led us to the interview with Adrienne Mayer on gods and robots. The hologram keeps shifting over the empire. No more.
You dedicated your life to the gods. Zeus, god of thunder. Athena, goddess of wisdom. You served them.
Yes, of course.
And Ares, god of war, who blankets his bed with the skin of men he's killed.
All the gods are to be feared and respected.
I'll tell you a secret. Something they don't teach you in your temple. Gods envy us. us because we're mortal. Because any moment might be our last. Everything's more beautiful because we're doomed. You will never be lovelier than you are now. We will never be here again.
This is the Aeon Byte interview, and with us, we definitely have the pleasure of being joined by Adrienne Mayer to discuss her new book, Gods and Robots, Myth, Machines, and Ancient Dreams of Technology. Thank you for being here, and how are you doing, Adrienne?
Thank you for having me. I'm having a good time.
Wonderful. It is a pleasure having you here on Aeon Byte, and with us, we have the Moondog Vance, who I've just found out was you reached the top of the mountain of the Talos principle, which is a big deal.
I did. Oh, yeah. That was great. I love that game. Yep. So this is going to be interesting. I've been interested in robots and artificial intelligence ever since I was 3 years old and dreamt I was a victim of a chase by a robot.
Wow. There you go. Well, I think this show might even help you, or it might trigger you, Vance. So we'll just have to see which way you go, which way your sanity goes.
I'm permanently triggered, so no problem.
There you go. It's the only way to be. So, well, Adrienne, again, as I mentioned, this book was amazing. I read it in 2 days. I couldn't put it down. It's so relevant to today.
Thank you.
In many ways, and it really offers a new vista to the ancients. You sort of put it all together, what they were dealing with and what they were speculating about so many issues that we are speculating today about artificial intelligence, immortality, synthetic life, and all that. So I know our audience will love your book, and I highly recommend it, but why don't we start with more or less the genesis of your book? As you write, part of the spark or the divine spark to write Gods and Robots was two movies that you watched, two movies that I loved when I was young, and those were Metropolis and Jason and the Argonauts. Tell us about this and the process of how Gods and Robots came to be.
Well, it came to be because I live in Silicon Valley, where I'm surrounded by all these advancements in technology and robotics. And as a historian of sort of science before science, the first inklings of the scientific impulse, I really wanted to see how deep are those desires and endeavors. And I found out they go back much further than anyone had imagined. Most people believe automatons were first developed in the Middle Ages when they had clockwork mechanisms. And there are some philosophers of science, I knew, that they had claimed that it's impossible for anyone in ancient times to imagine technologies beyond what already existed, which struck me as intuitively ridiculous, because how else do innovations come about unless people are imagining what doesn't already exist in technology? A lot of other scholars assume that all animated beings in ancient mythology were just inert matter brought to life by gods or magic, you know, like Adam and Eve or Pygmalion's ivory statue. But I wondered, was it possible the concepts of robots, artificial life, could have been imagined in classical antiquity much longer ago than anyone had thought? And I found that people were describing imaginary automatons as early as Homer. So that's more than 2,500 years ago. All of these myths that I discuss in my book, Gods and Robots, are actually examples of the first science fiction stories ever told. So Metropolis, which was, I think, came out in 1927, I talk about Jason and the Argonauts. Those are my two favorites as well, but I also, Jason and the Argonauts is a cult film from 63. I also talk about Frankenstein, the 1931 version, and the Blade Runner films from 82 and 2017, and other TV shows. And I think that the mythic tales from antiquity are just as cinematic. And that's one reason I love Jason and the Argonauts, because of the way Harryhausen brought Talos to life. It's just an iconic vision of that great bronze robot from Greek mythology.
Oh, I agree. I remember as a kid watching it, and they're running around in the island, and suddenly that statue turns his head.
Yes.
And I remember going, oh my God, this is worse than the Terminator. How are these guys going to defeat them? It just stayed with me.
Ooh. Exactly. And if you think about it, those ancient myths and those modern movies like Jason and the Argonauts and Metropolis and the others, they're about imaginary technology, and they are really cultural dreams. And I think of myths as cultural dreams, just the way I think of films as cultural dreams. They show the power of imagination. They allowed the audiences or the readers or the listeners to sort of ponder artificial life, how it might be created, if only you had sublime technology, and how it could be controlled and destroyed. All those things were being imagined back in the time of Homer.
They were indeed, and more than we could have ever imagined, and we've had so many misconceptions. But your book, Adrienne, details how the ancient Greeks were interested in the, quote, made not born idea that enthralls humanity more than ever today. Why do you think there was that interest back in then? I mean, I'm assuming, as you write, they were always trying to improve themselves against a harsh world. As you write, the first instant of the biotechne that you write was really armor. Putting armor was already making us machines.
Yes, and it's what's interesting is that the ancient armor made of bronze replicated a male nude torso, but with a musculature of a superhero like Hercules, so that a bunch of hoplites or soldiers in antiquity wearing this sort of human enhancement of bronze chest armor, they looked like a wall of robots approaching the enemy. It must have been quite startling, almost the same sensation that you had when you saw Talos come to life in Jason the Argonaut. Yeah.
And again, we're talking about made, not born. What would you say is the difference? Because obviously in the Abrahamic dispensation, we have Adam and Eve that are made, not born. But this is what? This is sort of how is the biotechne different in the Greek world? Or what were they trying to speculate?
Right. All of the automatons and artificial beings that were created through what the Greeks might have called biotechne, and that word comes from bio, which means life, and techne, which means craft or artifice. It's the roots of our word biotechnology, and that word was applied to that phrase, made not born, was applied to all of these beings that were the product of technology. They were made, most of them, by the god of invention, the blacksmith god Hephaestus. And the phrase made not born is a real crucial phrase, because it calls out their technological, non-biological origins. And yet they're sort of described as almost like cyborgs. If you think of Talos, the great bronze robot, he had an interior system of we know his inner workings. He had a single vein that went from his head down to his feet, and in that vein, and the ancient poets call it a vein or artery, they're using a biological word for this machine made of bronze. So he is sort of imagined as half machine, half human or biological, and in that vein pulsed ichor, which was the life fluid of the gods. That's what made the gods immortal. So we know his inner workings, and I think that's quite amazing for a story that was told 2,700 years ago. That's astounding, and it's very different from inert matter, as I mentioned before, or things, lifeless things brought to life by magic or a god's command or a magician. Adam and Eve were brought to life by God, just through his command. He didn't really use technology to make them. So that phrase, made not born, distinguishes these artificial beings from things magically enlivened. And in fact, all these marvels in the ancient myths that I describe were imagined as constructed using the same tools, same materials, the same methods that human craftsmen or blacksmiths used on Earth, but because they're made by the god Hephaestus, he achieved awesome results. It's really an imagining, a science fiction of what you could do with technology if you were a god.
Yes, and it should be noted that the word tech or technology simply means craft.
Yes, techne. Yeah, that's right.
That definitely puts a new perspective in. Could you briefly tell the audience, the listeners, about the myth of Talos, history's perhaps first robot?
Yes, he is the first automaton described in Greek mythology, first described by the poet Hesiod, who lived around the time of Homer. So we're talking about 750 to 650 BC. So this is a really ancient science fiction. He's a giant android made of bronze. We know his inner workings. He's made by the god Hephaestus, commissioned by the king god. Well, he's the tyrant god, Zeus. And he has asked Hephaestus to make this killer robot to give to his son, King Minos, who rules the kingdom of Crete. And Talos is charged with defending the island of Crete. He is you could say almost programmed. I mean, he's tasked with spotting strange ships that are approaching the coast of Crete, and he walks around the island, and we're told he walks around the island three times a day. Now, some people have calculated that would mean he has to travel more than 500 miles an hour. We're talking about science fiction here.
yeah, he can do that.
and we know that he can actually take action and interact with his surroundings and with the invaders. When he spots a ship coming toward the coast of Crete, he picks up boulders, giant boulders, ripping them off of the cliffs, and hurls them at the ships to sink them. And then should anyone come ashore, he can, in close combat, grab them up, heat his body to red hot, he's made of bronze, and crush them to his chest. That's a kind of a perverted embrace, right. Most of them alive. So Jason and the Argonauts are quite daunted by the sight of this giant robot looming over them. How will they escape this?
Yes, in the story, different than the movie, it's Medea who defeats Talos, right? It's not in the movie, it's Jason figures it out.
Yes, but in the actual myth, luckily, Jason and the Argonauts happen to have Medea, who is a sorceress or witch. She's kind of a techno wizard. She knows the secrets of liquid fire. She knows how to rejuvenate animals and humans in her magic. It's not even a magic cauldron of gold. It's actually some sort of biotechnical formula that she uses in this cauldron to rejuvenate people, bring them back to life, or increase their longevity, or give them their youth back. She knows all these sort of techno secrets, and she's the one who figures out the vulnerability of Talos. She says he's powered by ichor, and incidentally, he fits all the conditions of a modern robot. He can interact with his environment. He's self-moving. We know his inner workings, and we even know his power source. She knows his power source is ichor, which gives the gods their immortality. But she also knows that the entire system, his internal system, is sealed on his ankle with a bronze bolt. And so she knows that if she can remove that bolt, the ichor, his power source, will bleed out, and then he will not be immortal, and he will be destroyed. So she has to convince him to allow her to remove the bolt. And she is able to convince this robot of bronze to let her do that. She promises him that she can make him invulnerable, immortal. And she's guessing, gambling, that he has developed or evolved some human characteristics, the desire to be immortal. Sure enough, he agrees. And there's an interesting lesson there because, well, there are two lessons there. The people who deployed Talos, the killer robot, did not expect him to develop agency and make his own decisions.
Right.
But also it sort of points to this modern idea and fear that we have that AI will somehow develop its own desires and start making its own decisions based on what it wants. So I think it's rather amazing that those two features of the cyborg are there in such an ancient story.
I think so too. Again, we're talking about what Steven Spielberg and Ridley Scott and Philip K. Dick and Blade Runner, they're trying to figure out, can this machine be sentient? Can it have, yes, agency, consciousness, desire to evolve? And
yes,
it's right there, like you said, 2,600 years ago. And what's fascinating too is, as a kid, I remember watching Jason and the Argonauts, and you point this out in your book, but when Jason removes that, whatever, the valve from his Achilles heel,
yeah,
I thought, well, as a robot, he's just going to fall down, but you see him grab his chest and all that, and I remember as a kid, go, oh my God, he suffers. He has sentience. This is horrible.
Yes, and in antiquity, we know that the ancient Greeks also felt a certain sympathy for Talos when he was dying. That's when he seems most human, isn't it? Both in the 1963 movie, Jason and the Argonauts, but also on ancient Greek vases from the 5th century BC. And we also have vases that show Jason actually using a tool to remove that bolt. So, I mean, this just hammers home the idea that he is a product of technology and he is then destroyed by technology. But what's interesting is you point out that you feel this empathy for him when he's dying. It's exactly similar to in 2001, A Space Odyssey, when Hal is being disabled. That's when he seems most human. We tend to anthropomorphize robots and artificial intelligence, especially if they act like humans and if they have a name and a sort of personal backstory. We endow them with emotions and the ability to suffer, and we feel sort of pangs of empathy for them when they're damaged or destroyed. And in fact, we have vase paintings that show Talos at the moment of death. He's reeling backwards. His eyes are rolling up. And there is one ancient vase painter, 5th century BC, a vase that was painted in about 480 BC, actually shows a teardrop falling from the robot's eye.
Wow.
And we know that some of the ancient Athenian playwrights wrote plays in which Talos was featured. Those plays are lost, but we have some fragments of them. We can imagine that on stage, perhaps there was also a feeling of empathy for Talos when he was finally being destroyed.
And in a very interesting synchronicity, at the time of this interview, just 24 hours ago, Rutger Hauer, who played Roy Batty in Blade Runner, passed away yesterday. Oh. And of course, we're talking about Talos and his death, but his scene in Blade Runners with the speech "Tears and Rain" is exactly that. This, yes, being that suddenly is human because he knows he's going to die, and all he wants is a little bit more life.
He's programmed to live 4 years, I think, and they want more life. And the 4 years was apparently chosen because that would preclude them having these androids from developing emotions, desires, and memories. So they were given memories and bestowed with memories that were false. That was really moving, as you say.
Yes, exactly. And it is, well, again, such an amazing myth, but also somebody I wanted to talk to about because I think she is very underrated in mythology, and that's Medea. Even I wrote a science fiction novel that was published by Warner Books many years ago, and my main character or the female protagonist was Medea because I see her as the ultimate feminist, the ultimate femme fatale. you know, she is, you might say, the badass superhero of ancient time, perhaps all times. I mean, she is very powerful intelligence. I guess she has one weakness, which is unfortunately Jason.
She fell in love with Jason. That's right.
Her one big mistake.
But of course, she was looking for a way to escape from her tyrannical father.
Right.
So maybe this was her way out. She was a beautiful princess from the non-Greek kingdom. She was from Colchis on the Black Sea. So she's sort of a barbarian, exotic femme fatale, bewitching woman with, and she has her own set of all these mythic adventures. As I said, she had the keys to youth and age and life and death. She could hypnotize humans and animals. She could cast spells, and she could brew these powerful potions. I like to call her a techno wizard. She just sort of she can figure out anything. She's like a hacker. She figures out how to hack Talos.
But more than that, not only is she a hacker and a person who has mastery over techne, but also you talk about she is also a master of pharmakeia. She knows the potions and the medicines and all that. So she's very formidable.
Oh, yes. She knows how to... Jason asks her to rejuvenate his father, who has grown old and frail in their absence. And she promises that she can do that. But in the ancient myth, she actually admits that this is an experiment on her part, that she's never done this for a human, only for animals. So it's quite interesting that her first experiments with rejuvenation, she uses an old ram and puts it in her cauldron, her golden cauldron, along with all these powerful substances and pharmaca, drugs, and pulls out a young lamb out of the cauldron, which proves that she has the ability to rejuvenate. And so she's now going to sort of extrapolate that to a human being. It's very interesting that in the myth, she says, this is the first time I'm going to do this with a human, so let's hope it works. And I think what's really interesting is sort of a mytho-scientific process that kind of prefigures cloning and the first cloning experiments were with sheep.
With sheep, yeah.
That's really an interesting little prefiguring by the myth. I'm very careful not to draw any direct lines from these ancient myths to our modern technology, but that really struck me as a coincidence.
Yes.
With Dolly, the genetically engineered lamb, who begins life in a test tube. She's the cloned lamb is nurtured in a sort of soup, a growth medium, in the laboratory experiment. I think it was 1995, 96. And then her life ended. Dolly died at age 6, and that was half the lifespan of a natural sheep. So that obviously was an experiment. Now we've by now scientists are able to create artificial wombs and man-made amniotic fluids, and they've sustained living lamb fetuses, and they grow human cells in modified sheep embryos. So you could say that's a long line that started with Medea's cauldron.
And Dolly lived twice as long as Roy Batty. So.
Interesting.
And of course, for the audience, I mean, again, Medea and Jason are going on these adventures, and she's pretty much the one who's saving him. She's the one he's the damsel in distress.
Absolutely. What was very interesting in the ancient myth is that Jason is a Greek hero, and yet he's so passive and clueless. He depends on Medea for so much, which I think just gives her, as you say, makes her a very powerful figure in Greek mythology. She helped him win the Golden Fleece. Without her, they would not have been able to possess the fleece. Her father, King Aetes, promised to give Jason the Golden Fleece if he could carry out these impossible, deadly missions. He had a pair of bronze bulls that were created by Hephaestus. These are robo bulls. They're gigantic bulls made of bronze that breathe fire. And Jason has to yoke them to a plow and then plow a field while planting a helmet full of dragon's teeth that are going to sprout an instant army of android soldiers. I mean, this is a great science fiction story. But Medea is the one who saved him. She created a magic potion for Jason made from ichor that would, for 24 hours, make him invulnerable to fire or invulnerable to the fire that was breathed by these robo bulls and the dragon teeth army. She figured that out and made him invulnerable for the 24 hours that it took to accomplish these tasks. So she really comes to his rescue. And then when the army starts sprouting out of this plowed field, it's an army of automatons, really. They just keep coming, and she figures out once again what is their vulnerability. She's the techno wizard. She hacks that army. She tells Jason, just throw some stones into the middle of this advancing army of armed androids, and that will trigger their attack mode because they feel the rocks hitting their shields, and they are programmed to attack the nearest so-called enemy. They attack each other, and now they're just a confused frenzy, and Jason and the Argonauts can now run in and finish them off. But it was Medea who figured that out.
She is definitely the one. And of course, in the movie, Jason and the Argonauts, they take that away, and Jason has to be the macho guy figuring things out. But
that's right.
That was Hollywood in the 60s.
The scene is just unforgettable, though. I mean, you can't think of that army without remembering that film, I think.
Yes, yes. I agree 100%. Wonderful film. And also somebody we definitely, when we're talking about techne, somebody we definitely have to bring about is the great, you talk about the god of the forge of the Greeks, but we need to talk about Prometheus, who, yes. And of course, Medea, I believe, as you say, she used some of Prometheus's power in one of her adventures.
Well, you remember that Prometheus is the one who, he created the first human beings and animal. But then his brother, who was a very short-sighted guy, Epimetheus.
He's such a dunce. He's like the dumbest sidekick.
Well, you know, it's right there in their names. Prometheus means, in ancient Greek, foresight, looking ahead. Epimetheus means hindsight, or unable to look ahead. So the Greeks had a sense of humor about this. But so Prometheus, he feels sorry for these vulnerable humans. So he steals fire and shows humans how to use fire, which, of course, is a technology that allows them to create language, to communicate and plan and build other technologies. So the tyrant Zeus, God, the god of the of all the other gods, the father of gods and men, he's very vindictive about this. He punishes Prometheus for giving humans the gift of fire. He chains him to a mountain, and we all know the story. He sends a giant eagle to peck out his liver every day, which regenerates. Here we have another science fiction. The Greeks apparently understood that livers can regenerate. Very interesting little detail in that myth. Also, some versions of the myth say that Hephaestus created that eagle out of bronze. So now we have to imagine a kind of drone-like eagle coming every day to torture Prometheus. Well, when the eagle comes, ichor drips out of the wound that he makes, and a certain flower grows there that is watered by this ichor. Medea goes to that mountaintop, collects the ichor, and that's the drug that she uses to make Jason invulnerable for 24 hours.
Yes, indeed. And of course, it should be mentioned that later on as Prometheus, as the myth came, he didn't just bring them fire. Didn't he teach them speech and all these things? Because his brother, Epiphanius, I'm mispronouncing, he gave all the cool stuff to the other animals. Like he gave lions claws and eagle sight. And there was no good characteristic for humans.
That's right. Once again, we see the humor of the of their. I found it very fascinating to come across all these little carved gems from the 4th and 3rd century BC that show Prometheus creating the prototypical human being, and he's starting with the framework, working from the inside out, working with a skeleton. First, and he's shown using tools, plumb lines, hammers, and mallets, and things like that. So we are given to understand that we humans are the product of technology, which I thought was really quite amazing. And there's a sort of a if you think about the Gnostics and Gnosticism, about the does that mean that we're all puppets of the gods? And that's a question that Plato asked. If we're the creations of the gods, especially through technology, how can we have self-identity and some agency and free will? Plato discussed that. He's one of the first to ever sort of float the idea of humans as sort of non-autonomous creatures. I think the quote is, "Let us suppose that each of us living creatures is an ingenious puppet of the gods." I think he said that in the Laws. So he's playing a sort of thought experiment there. That it's occurred to everyone, of course. That sort of suffuses traditional Hindu and Buddhist and Taoist tales about robots. There's a Hindu story, for instance, in which some people come across an entire city populated by silent townspeople and animals. And then later they find out that they're just realistic automatons or puppets, all controlled by a solitary man on a throne hidden in the palace. It's sort of a Wizard of Oz feeling to the whole thing.
Wow.
So this idea that maybe humans are automatons or playthings of a evil demiurge or a tyrant or a all supreme god, that's a really ancient idea as well.
Yes, and of course in the occult you've got the idea of the Anunnaki. We've got the movie Prometheus by Ridley Scott.
Yeah.
Who, the ancient aliens, these gods created us. And as you mentioned too, when you start reading these stories, people say, well, what was wrong with the Gnostics thinking that the creator and ruler of the universe would be such a jerk? Yeah. And then you say, well, just look at Zeus. It was right there.
Yes, and that brings us to the modern one of the modern fears that people have at the AI and robotics is that it's expressed as does technology favor tyranny? Who is it that is going to deploy and develop these things but tyrants? It appeals to tyrants. And so this past year, I was investigating that idea to see how ancient are those roots. And you said it, Zeus is a harsh, vindictive tyrant. And he's the one who deploys the killer robot. And he also created Pandora, which is an evil fembot, similar to Maria, the robotic Maria in Metropolis.
Right.
So when Hephaestus makes these self-moving devices and automatons for the use of the gods, up in the heavens, he made, you know, a fleet of driverless carts that would deliver nectar and ambrosia to the gods at their feast and then return on their own when they were empty. He made a bank of automatic bellows for his forge that could blow, you know, just exactly how much air he needed at his work. He made a crew of golden women who were endowed with all the knowledge of the gods. That's a version of AI. All these things are really sort of charming and very benign when they're used by the gods. He made automatic gates for heaven that open and close as the gods drove their chariots in and out of the heavens. It's sort of the first automatic garage doors. These are all sort of cute ideas. But then when these self-moving devices and automatons and artificial beings are sent down to Earth to interact with humans on the earthly plane, that's when they wreak havoc, and that's when there's a lot of mayhem and killing, and Asimov's laws get broken.
Exactly. I think, yeah, that's a lesson that, sure, Elon Musk and those guys can use technology, but for us little mortals down here, it's a mixed result, which is what you write in. It's always going to be mixed results with technology and humans.
Yeah, that's right. I think not only is Zeus a tyrant who deploys these things, but then in the myths, who else deploys them? Autocrats like Medea's father, King Aedes. He's the one who has the robo bulls, the bronze bulls. And then there were other mythical kings who deployed these creatures. The killer robot, after all, belonged to King Minos, another tyrant. But then I wondered, what about actual historical times? Did technology appeal to autocratic rulers? And it did. I found all sorts of examples going back to the 6th century BC of real historical autocrats and tyrants who commissioned machines of malice, machines to torture and kill their citizens and enemies.
You know, Adrienne, there is another example of an artificial intelligence that's been with mankind ever since civilization started, which is the hierarchical organization. Because when you have a set of laws, right, and you have a bunch of minions that have to follow the laws, even though they may deviate from the laws, such a structure acts just like a machine. It really is a machine in the sense of, you know, following programs, you know, achieving intended objectives by the controllers and so forth and so on, right?
Yes, and it's expected to be sort of perpetually, like a perpetual motion machine, as you say. For instance, when King Minos set up Talos, he was expected to be a perpetually working guardian for King Minos. He was never expected to deviate from his programmed tasks, but he did. And so that's part of the hope and fear of technology and perhaps of machine-like organisms and organizations.
You mentioned too, Adrienne, the myth of Pandora, which I found just as fascinating. And this one's been, might say, misconstrued or not seen right. Because even the other day, Adrienne, I was watching, there's a TED Talk where they do the Greek myths. And in this one, like we've all been taught, is basically Pandora is like the first woman. And she's the first woman, and she's created really curious. And then they take her down to Earth, and she's sort of like Epiphanius, the brother of Prometheus's brother. I mean, he's Adam, and Pandora's Eve, and she creates the first mistake by opening the box, which wasn't a box. But as you write, Pandora was never human.
She was never human. She was described as an artificial woman. She was commissioned by Zeus once again to punish humans for accepting the gift of fire. And she was described as a evil disguised as beauty. She was supposed to arouse lust in men. And then she was sent to Earth with one mission, to open that jar. Originally it was a jar that was filled with all of the suffering and misfortunes that plague mankind forever. So this is a very vindictive and not a pleasant fairy tale like we've been taught. In the original Greek myth, She's not an innocent young woman endowed with a tragic sense of curiosity. In fact, she's never called the first woman, and she is never described as curious. She is an artificial woman, and the ancient vase paintings from the 5th century BC show the gods preparing her. She's a replicant young woman being prepared for her mission on Earth. And in the vase painting, you can see her standing very stiffly with her arms at her sides, looking out straight ahead at the audience or the viewers. She looks like a wind-up doll. She's got this eerie, sort of vacuous smile on her face. She's nothing like the fairy tale version that we've heard. She is being endowed with all these gifts. Her name is ironic once again. I point out that the Greeks always had a sense of humor about these myths. Her name is Pandora. It means all gifts. She was given all these attributes by the gods. Aphrodite, the goddess of love, gives her dazzling beauty and the ability to arouse lust in men. Others give her various other gifts. Hermes, the messenger of the gods, he gives her the mind of a female dog, which is another bit of sense of humor there for the Greeks in the myth. But it's about a really terrible thing. It's trying to explain where does evil come from. And she's sent to Earth with this one mission. She is to insinuate herself into human society and then open that jar. We never hear from her again. She doesn't have any parents. She has no childhood. She has no memories. She has no agency. And she disappears after her task is finished. And then in the fairy tale version that we all know, what's the last thing in the jar? It's hope. And if you think of the fairy tale illustrations that you've seen, it's like a little fairy that comes out at the end that is supposed to comfort mankind because of all these ills that have been released upon us. Actually, nothing like the original story. In the original Greek myth and in original Greek, ancient Greek thought, hope was not good. Hope was another evil. So philosophers have debated whether hope was maybe the worst thing in her jar, because it deprives us of the ability to look ahead, to anticipate, to be like Prometheus.
But don't you say also that in one of the myths, Prometheus gave man the idea to hope or to never care about destruction, which is a great tale. It's like humans, sometimes we just got to invent things and hope for the best.
Yes, that vision of Prometheus bestowing hope on mankind comes from a play that was written by, I can't remember the name of which playwright it is, but it's an Athenian tragedy where Prometheus, the character Prometheus in the play, is giving the playwright is making a new version of the myth. And he says that it was Prometheus who gave mankind hope so that they would be a blessing not to be able to look ahead at all the disasters that are going to befall them. Once again, though, that is ironic and controversial because it's a tragedy.
Speaking of Zeus being the demiurge, I think you're right. There is a play where that big jerk, he's like chuckling up in the clouds, like, wait till they open this box, you know, the jar.
Yes, we see, we are given a vision of him actually laughing out loud as he plans this disaster for humans, this eternal disaster for humankind. And then there is an ancient vase painting that shows Zeus admiring Pandora, and he's holding this sort of doll-like, mannequin-like figure in his lap and just admiring it and smiling.
Oh, dear. Terrible, terrible.
Once again, technology favors tyranny. We have an example there.
That is a big, the big lesson here.
Yeah.
I mean, and another big lesson, and actually a little sidetrack, because you talked about Plato talking, are we the playthings of the gods? Are we just constructs? Do we have agency and only the gods really have agency?
Yeah.
But there is also an amazing passage. You talk about Aristotle, and you say he's defending slavery. If we didn't have slavery, we wouldn't have civilization and all that good stuff.
Yes.
And all of a sudden, you said you were startled because he starts talking about, well, maybe if we had robots, it would solve slavery.
It's very interesting passage because Aristotle famously has a very dubious, illogical argument for justifying slavery. He says that there are natural slaves and that some people are natural slaves. And it's a very illogical argument. And right in the middle of it, he actually starts musing and on the ancient myths that we're just talking about, on these ancient stories of Hephaestus creating all these self-moving devices and labor-saving devices and automatons. And Aristotle says, well, if only we had looms that could weave on their own, if we had musical instruments that could play themselves, we would have no need for slaves. And it's just an amazing moment in his argument. And he doesn't continue the thought. He goes back to justifying slavery because, after all, he's just talking about myths. But it implies that he might not be the only one who used these myths to think with, you know, think about what the future might be like, or what alternate world we could have if we did have such advanced technology.
Yes, I mean, obviously they were already speculating this. And also, on another little side note, I had no idea, but another movie I loved as a kid was Fantasia, especially The Sorcerer's Apprentice. And in your book, you say this is an ancient story.
Yes, it is. Well, as you remember, Mickey Mouse is the apprentice of the sorceress, and when the sorcerer is away, Mickey plays with the magic wand and causes the broom to become a water carrier, and it just keeps multiplying. Well, that's an ancient Roman story. It's a story of an apprentice to a sorcerer or a wizard, of an Egyptian wizard, who has the ability to make household implements into his servants and to make them multiply. And then he can make them stop when he wants them to stop. But the apprentice doesn't know that secret. So it's a very amusing story about who controls technology and the tricks that you have to be able to control it and deploy technology for your own benefit.
Yes, indeed. So many harsh lessons and important lessons thousands of years ago. It's just it's amazing. And an issue today, another very important issue today, Adrienne, is the idea of sex worker robots, or having sex with machines. And obviously, again, we're going back to Blade Runner, because two of the replicants, that was their programming, to be sex robots for the people out in space, the miners up in space. But again, this is something that the ancients had already addressed, and that is the myth of Pygmalion. Could you explain to the audience about that one?
Yes, I remember in Blade Runner the billboards that said our sex replicants are more human than human.
Right, yes.
So the story of Pygmalion and Galatea. Once again, we think of that as a sort of nice romantic story, but the original story from antiquity, the most complete story we have, was told by the poet Ovid, writing in Roman times, and he recounts the myth of Pygmalion, a young man who was disgusted by real women. He wanted an ideal virgin as his companion, and so he carved an ivory, very realistic ivory statue of his ideal virgin woman to be his companion. He made love to that statue every night, and then during the day he would go and pray in the temple of Venus, a goddess of love, asking her to bring his statue to life. Well, the gods often grant wishes, I think usually maliciously just to see what will happen with the humans. She granted his wish, and the next time he went home and began to make love to the statue came alive under his caress. And Abba describes it, the transformation, in a really interesting way, I think, kind of a creepy way. He says that her skin didn't really feel like human skin. It felt more like wax that is becomes warm to the touch the more you mold it. And he actually uses the word, she became useful by being used. And if that isn't a sex robot, I don't know what is. I mean, it's a kind of creepy story. It's not a romantic story. So once again, we've kind of cleaned up these old myths and made them into fairy tales.
And My Fair Lady, the movie. And stuff. But we have come around, Adrienne. I mean, a movie you mentioned is Ex Machina, which deals with this, the sex robots and controlling the women. And, of course, the HBO show Westworld is all about this, a lot of sex robots, and they rise up.
Yes. I mean, that's always the fear that they will develop their own agency and desires and act on their own for their own benefit. In the story of Pygmalion, we never hear that, though. She has no agency. She doesn't have any real desire. She has no emotions. She has no memories. She really is just an automaton created for sex. So we've sort of evolved away from that story.
Yes, but there's also another one which I want you to share. And this one, actually, I thought was really touching. And that is the one about the woman whose husband goes to the Trojan War and she has to find a replacement, right? Even after he dies.
Yes, I think it's really interesting that there is a story about a woman commissioning a statue, a very realistic statue of her husband, who is a soldier who's been sent to fight the Trojan War, which we all know, thanks to Homer, it dragged on for 10 years. So her husband has been gone for a decade. And she has this statue secretly in her bedroom and makes love with this statue. And she is observed by a servant who tells her father about it. And the father then confiscates the statue and burns it. It's a really tragic story. Actually, that story, I would say, is more romantic than the Pygmalion story.
Yeah. Yes, I would agree.
Yeah.
Is that how it ends? The statue's burned, or there's something that happens after that?
We don't have so much of ancient literature has been lost. We have a few versions of that story. In some of them, she kills herself afterwards. There's another version where a soldier, and it might be the same soldier, we're not really sure, asks the gods for to grant his wish of being able to go back to be with his wife after he dies for just one night. It could have been that. It could have been a version of that story. But once again, it's a very romantic and tragic story.
Yes, I got emotional of it. I'm glad I ran into it. And I think all of this happens, again, drawing a parallel, we can go back to Blade Runner, because Blade Runner 2049 really starts dealing with the more intimate parts of human relation, machine and human relationships, specifically having children. What could happen?
Yes, and that's an interesting point that you're bringing up there, because I said we don't hear anything more of Pandora or the ivory statue until in very later Roman times, during the Roman Empire, some poets imagined that that Pandora and Epimetheus did have offspring, and that Pygmalion and his ivory statue who came to life also had offspring. So here we have that sort of irresistible temptation to make these women so alive, even though they began as automatons, make them into sort of cyborgs that could actually biologically reproduce. And that, as you say, that's one of the themes of the Blade Runner 2049. The shocking idea that these cyborgs actually became biological.
I think, and this is something that got speculated. I mean, as you say, you give example that even Descartes, he speculated centuries and a long time after, he speculated that we are going to have to be able to tell the difference between man and the machine, right?
Yes, that's right. I remember in Blade Runner, was it Rutger Hauer who says, "I think, therefore I am"? At one point, one of the replicants said,
"Good one." Do you remember, Vance?
No, I don't. I don't remember that quote. But they had the test, remember? Then it had two names.
The Voight-Kampff test. Yes.
Yeah, that's it was similar to the Turing test. And of course, going back to the Gnostic idea that we could be puppets of gods, how can you do a Turing test on yourself to prove that you're not an animal?
You're right.
Yeah, it was based on empathy, right? That's in fact in the book too. In the Androids Dream of Electric Sleep, do androids dream of electric sleep?
Do they have empathy? Yes,
that was the big theme of the novel. It was a little bit watered down in the movie, but
yes. Yeah. But you're right, Descartes, and now this is the French philosopher who lived in the. He's writing in about 1600. He was actually familiar with the mechanical automatons of his time in France, powered by sort of clockwork gears and springs. And there were a lot of these made during that, during his day. And so maybe that is why he began thinking that way. He embraced this idea of thinking of the body as a kind of machine, a machine itself, the human body as a machine. And he was sort of anticipating the Turing test and the other spin-offs from the Turing test. Descartes did predict that someday we humans might need a way to figure out whether someone or something was a machine or a real human being. And he said that if there were machines that were androids that looked imitate our bodies, and then could actually move like us, then we would need a test that, and he imagined that the test would be based on whether they would have linguistic abilities like humans, or that if they could be flexible in their behavior, which I think those are, it's very interesting that he was trying to ponder how would you tell machine from a human being in 1600.
Yes, and going back to machine and the tyrants, I love one part of your book. You're talking about Isaac Asimov's law of robotics, don't harm and all that. But you postulate that, well, when you look at Pandora, she followed the law of robotics because there's nothing about not harming humanity as a whole.
Yes.
They found a loophole.
And Asimov had to write the fourth law, the zeroth law, which is must be beneficial to all humanity.
She was the reason for number four.
He broke off.
That would shut them all down. There's nothing beneficial to everybody. I have one last question. I think this is a good question, which is, could it be that human beings have something built into our programming that eventually leads to us replacing ourselves, and that's why we are in such a push? And even in, as evidence in the ancient Greeks, they even knew about these kinds of constructs, robots, then, that we are programmed to replace ourselves.
And you know, everyone thinks of that when we think of the cutting edge, advanced robotics, and all the people who in Silicon Valley are trying to not just extend our lifespan way beyond what would be natural, but even contemplating immortality. And of course, I devote a whole chapter to the practical and ethical problems of immortality. But probably more realistically, the people who are thinking that we will become more and more a melding of humans and machines, and living much beyond what we think of as a normal lifespan, because cells are programmed to die. And so even all of the people who work on the project of it, extending human lifespans, refer to the problem of degeneration of cells as the Tithonus problem. How can you grow old without growing decrepit? And they're referring to an ancient Greek myth of Tithonus, the mortal who was beloved by a goddess, the goddess of dawn. And she fell in love with this mortal. She could not bear the idea that he would die, that he was not immortal like she was. She asked the gods to make him immortal. And once again, the gods granted that wish without telling her what the problem was. They made Tithonus immortal. And she had forgotten to request that he stay young. And he grew older and older and older, and he could not die. He just became a sort of a vegetable, no longer able to even move or speak. And she, with great sorrow, the myth says she locked him in a golden room where he babbles on forever. Just the idea of this has really struck the scientists in Silicon Valley who are trying to extend human lifespans without cells degenerating, without people getting old. They refer to it as the Tithonus problem. So there are a lot of problems with trying to replace ourselves with AI. I mean, practical and ethical problems, moral problems. What happens to human memory? What happens to love? What happens to selflessness or sacrifice? The gods are immortal, but no one refers to them as heroic or brave. The stakes are too low. If you live forever, the stakes are very low.
Well, the people that are saying to us we can become immortal by uploading our memories into robots, they don't worry about all those, human qualities.
Yes, but then, of course, the inequalities that will happen. I mean, who will be able to afford this? Who will die and who will stay immortal?
The ones on Olympus will be able to, as always, not the same as it ever was. So our hard lessons, and I would tell the audience, look at the myths, look at these great myths, because, again, we can get Jungian or Campbellian. That's where the collective unconscious, the repository of so many symbols and lessons and the essence of human being and the gods. But I would also say, please get Adrienne's book, Gods and Robots. We only scratched the surface. And there is so much more. There are so many other great lessons in it, so much great scholarship. But we are coming at the end. Vance, thanks for keeping us company on this journey to Olympus.
Oh, I had no choice. I was programmed to do so.
There you go. Tears and rain, Vance. Tears and rain. Yes. But Adrienne, thank you so much for coming on AM by Gnostic Radio. Again, I highly recommend this book, and I'm very grateful that you made this happen, and thank you for coming.
Thank you. I really enjoyed our conversation.
And there you have it, my beloved True Seekers. Our interview with Adrienne Mayer on a remarkable book, Gods and Robots. The hologram shifts over the empire. Always Gnostic times. Same as it ever was. But you're here to make a difference. As mentioned in the intro, we could only do a little over an hour with Adrienne. As a bonus for members and patrons, Vance and I discussed the interview. Since Vance is very, very familiar with Silicon Valley and the military-industrial complex, he provided some amazing insights. You'll love it. As a further bonus, as I mentioned, I'm adding the section of our interview with Jason Reza Georgiani on his book, Prometheus and Atlas.
where he presents a framework where we can use the power of the Titans against the Olympian gods of any age or geography. More needed than ever. And yes, even if you're a patron or member of the Archives, you're listening to this right now. I simply wanted to thank you for all the support you provide every week and every month. I'm blessed by your company, your insights, and your feedback. I can't show you my gratitude enough. I hope I have served you in your overthrowing of Zeus. This has been Aeon Byte's best year, and your continued and further support could grant me the ability to offer even more content. So for the 95% of you still not getting the full shows and all the rewards, including building a strong, Gnostic-minded community, please support. And for everyone else, please spread the word in these dim-tide times. Remember now that I have a Discord channel as well as other bonuses for supporting the show. And damn, the conversations are enlightening. I also have an Amazon wish list now at thegodabovegod.com if you want to help me out there. Again, thank you so much. And glad you're here with me on this dark odyssey through the gnashing rocks of orthodoxy all the way to the farthest shores of imagination. As we keep running with those searching for the truth and avoiding those who have found it. Zeus and Buddha are always on the road, and we can kill them both. And still write our own gospel and live our own myth. Alright. For patrons and members of the Archives, let us to our bonus section. For the rest, I'll see you on the dark side of Olympus. Hello and goodbye as always.